thousands of people to arrive. Let's learn the last hymn, which is one that Caleb reminded me of, the existence thereof. It's called All Are Welcome. It's right at the very end of the service sheet. And it's a really good hymn. I don't think we've sung it before. So let's warm ourselves up. And in the meantime, vast numbers of people will come through the door. So would you like to make a waltz set then? So it starts at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and there will be the bar will be open in the evening for any open mic or music that people want to make. And during the afternoon, the Sacred Justice Circle from Union Chapel will be doing two things. One is having conversations. So they'll be inviting people just to join a circle and have a chat, and Kate is looking after that. And the other will be to do some creative things, which Heather is doing. So we'll have a visual record of our event as well. And then on the 1st of July, that Sunday, the 1st of July, Kate will come and tell us a little bit about what those conversations. So I hope you join us then. Yes. Three hands go up now. Karen, you were first.
There is a barbecue on Wednesday.
So there is.
Weather permitting, I do believe. But it's a barbecue for all of us staff and stakeholders in Union Chapel, and so anyone is welcome. All are welcome. Come along, bring us something to drink. From six, half six-ish.
Andy, you were next.
Starting an induction course for new members, and and I'll be coordinating the first couple of meetings at any rate. So if you want to join the induction course for new members, then get in touch with me. So see me after the service.
So anybody interested in learning more about the church, becoming a member or associated with the church, Dr. Graham. We're going to see, it was worth it, wasn't it? It worked. I said, if I keep talking, more people will come and you all arrive. It's great. So we're going to start with reading from the Psalms. And Masashi's going to help us a little bit with this. We'll sing the Tese chant, Bless the Lord My Soul. We've sung it quite a few times now. So by the time we come to the end of this psalm, we'll sing it probably about six times, and Masashi will add fancy bits on the top. Fancy bits are called an ostinato. But that means he sings, but we keep singing. So we keep singing the chant, and Masashi will add the fancy bits. But let's, and we say together as well, us sing or say together the words that are involved. So. Trees of the Lord are full of sap, the cedars of Lebanon which he planted, in which the birds build their nests, while the fir trees are a dwelling for the stork. O Lord, how manifold are your ways, in wisdom you have made me. The earth is full of your creatures. All of these look to you to give them their food in due season. When you give it to them, they gather it. You open your hand and they are filled. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice. rejoice in his words. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will make music to my God while I have my being. So shall my song please him while I rejoice in the Lord.
Joyful, joyful, we adore you. procedure. I will set it out.
It's me.
I will break off a tender one from the top of the twigs. I myself will plant it on a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain height of Israel. In order to let, that it may produce boughs of their fruit and become a noble cedar. Every kind of bird will live. In the shade of its branches will nest winged creatures of every kind. All the trees of the field shall know that I am the Lord. I bring low the high tree. I make high the low tree. I dry up the green tree. I make the dry tree flourish. I, the Lord, have spoken. I will accomplish it. And the second reading is taken from the Bible. He also said, the kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day. And the split seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces on its own. First the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with a sickle, because the harvest has come. He also said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up, puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in the shade. With many such parables he spoke the word to them, as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples.
Our next hymn is nice poetry about creation. And Masashi's going to sing the first two verses, and we will join in with the third and fourth verse. You can stay seated for this. Quite effective. A lovely one I just found in the club, the moon, earth rises.
Come.
three surgeons came and chopped off a significant part of a tree outside a window. And now it looks pretty bald. But I keep looking because I'm pretty sure that sometime, if not this year, by next spring, that tree will have sprouted many, many twigs and leaves just as it had previously. It will be an image in front of my window of the miracle of creation. Today is kind of story time. Today, our story that we read from the Bible is a simple tale of country folk. First is the story of a man who goes out to his field and he sows some seed and it grows. He doesn't know how, but it does, just as I don't know quite how, but I'm sure that the twigs will appear on the tree. First the blade and then the ear, then the full corn shall appear. And when it is ready, the farmer comes with his sickle, cuts it down, simple, everyday example of the miracle of creation. And then there's another story from Jesus. The farmer takes the smallest seed of all, a mustard seed. He plants it and it grows into a shrub. Indeed, it grows into the biggest shrub you can possibly imagine. This is a Jack and the Beanstalk story, really, the truth be told. The biggest shrub imaginable. In fact, its branches are so big that all of the birds of the air can come and rest in its branches. And that would have made people laugh. We take Jesus' parables incredibly seriously, but actually there's always a kind of humour built in, and the humour comes out of exaggeration, because the mustard seed is not the smallest seed there ever was. And the mustard plant is not the biggest tree that you could possibly imagine, it's just a bush, really. But Jesus would have had the audience there having a laugh at this stretch of the imagination. This is what the kingdom of God is like. Aha. And how many times have we had the conversation about church attendance? How we remember the glory days. You know, when I would have been standing in that pulpit preaching to 1,700 people in this place. And how many times have you heard the sermon that goes, there was Jesus with his 12 people plus Jesus. There he was. And that has now grown into 2.3 billion Christians around the world. Just an example of how the tiny seed grows into this massive tree. I think it's quite an interesting idea. Quite an idea that the tiny acorn or the mustard seed of Jesus' ministry grows into this mighty oak or the mustard shrub that we call the church. And that idea was very popular in the century when this church was built. The 19th century thought everything was going to go for them. It was the century of Charles Darwin, who said that Earth, you know, that we began as monkeys and then we grew and developed and developed, and everything is developing and everything is evolving and the world is moving on and on and on. It was the century of Karl Marx, who said that after the revolution, we'd have the proletariat of the people and the withering away of the state, and justice would reign across the earth. The whole idea was that everything was going to grow and become fantastic and big, and all our problems were going to solve. All we need to do is keep progressing, keep evolving. And I bet you any money that one of the best hymns that people in this congregation would have enjoyed. There would be a ripple of excitement when this hymn was announced. The whole wide world for Jesus, this shallow watch would be. From the highest mountains down to the deepest sea, the whole wide world for Jesus, to him shall all men bow, in city and in prairie, the world for Jesus now. The whole wide world, proclaim the gospel tidings through the whole wide world. Lift high the cross for Jesus, his banner lifted high, till every tongue confess it through the whole wide world. Well, last Sunday, Karen told us that there was no such thing as madness. And so, I am going to stop talking to you for the moment, and I'm going to talk to the ghosts. I'm going to talk to our ancestors. You were just plain wrong. It was a conceit to think that the world was progressing in a straight line towards perfection. It was a conceit to think that Christianity will grow into an unassailable force throughout the whole wide world. And the century that followed, with two world wars, with a plethora of proxy wars in Asia, Latin America, and Africa, with the growth of inequality of income between nations, with the Somme, with Auschwitz, with Hiroshima, with Stalin's pogroms, with the killing fields of Cambodia, Rwanda, Congo, Bosnia, Sudan, with the tyranny of armed borders, no, we are not progressive. And while this optimistic faith may have filled the pews once, those wars put an end to Europe's confidence in the Christian faith. And when people tell the story of Union Chapel, they will say, congregations started to decline with those wars. They were the wars that killed off this congregation. So perhaps the mustard seed is not this great little thing that's going to grow into this fantastic Christendom, this fantastic Christian empire. So modern writers about the story of the parable of the gospel seed, mustard seed, have tried to put a new spin on it. A more contemporary way, and I must admit, I have been very guilty of preaching sermons like this, where we see the mustard seed as a bit of a weed, as an irritant, as something which grows when it shouldn't grow, that is an annoying plant, that was somehow or other anathema to the people who were listening to them. Maybe there was some kind of subversive message in this, a contradiction to the mighty rulers of the world, the mighty empires who were the cedars of Lebanon, these great, great empires. And what do we have? Who are we? We're just a mustard seed. We are growing. We're continuing. We are. It was a Jewish author who pointed out to me something in her book. She pointed something I thought was really, really amusing. She said, actually, what are you Christians talking about? Mustard seed is not impure or a weed or anything, she said. Can you imagine a Jewish person eating a kosher sausage without a dollop of mustard on it? What are you talking about? And did Jesus really regard us as a bunch of weeds? Okay, so maybe if this parable is not about church growth, maybe if it's not about just being annoying irritants, what is it about? And what about the birds? We haven't mentioned the birds yet. The birds come from all over the place to rest in the branches of this great mustard seed bush. So is this parable, people say, about diversity? Is it about equal opportunities? Is it about all the different nations coming together? Is it about the Gentiles joining with the Jews in the shade of the tree of faith? And we're told again and again and again that we don't need to worry about church growth in our generation. Because although it's pretty well in decline in Europe, the church is growing in Africa. Growing in Latin America, the church is growing in Asia, nothing to worry about. So the birds are nesting in the tree of faith, and we European Christians may just be a little sparrow in that tree, but we're still there, hanging on. So the mustard seeds parable has developed a myriad of interpretations. It's grown with all these different interpretations. When I mentioned this Jewish author, Amy Jill Levine, who just said this, she said, actually, sometimes a seed is just a seed. A bird is just a bird. A tree is just a tree. You don't need to impose onto this story lots of interpretations. Just receive it for what it is. She, as a Jewish writer, wasn't interested in reading into the story salvation or incarnation or redemption or any of those fancy things. She wanted the story to speak for itself as a Jewish storyteller, Jesus. For the story tells of a seed that grows into a tree, into which the birds of the air can live together, healthily. And that's what the kingdom of God is like. Seed grows secretly, it's part of creation. The birds of the air, which settle in its green and spacious branches, are part of the ecology of creation. And that's what the kingdom of God is like. And if you look carefully with open and optimistic eyes, you will see the generosity of God in creation all around you. It is something we know we can trust, just as I'm sure that the tree outside my window will survive. If you want to live in the kingdom of God, sometimes you just need to leave well alone, because the kingdom is growing secretly but surely. Nothing we will do will change that. Our forebears were keen to force the gospel on people, on the nation, on the empire, and on people of other faiths. And there are still some who still do. And you can see the result of that here in these empty pews. If we trust God, and God is at work, nurturing simple faith and generous action into something deep and lasting. Sometimes we have to get out of the way, just as the sower of the seed got out of the way and let nature do its job. Not everything is about us. Not everything is on our shoulder. We don't have to have massive aspirations. We don't need to think that if we don't fill this chapel every Sunday, we're somehow failing God. And if we don't defeat fascism, racism, or save the planet in the next 10 years, but we have played our part in creating an environment where people and plants and animals are cared for, then we can allow God bring our work and the work of millions of others to come into fruition. Rather, we just ask, where is God's kingdom? It is here. And we can ask, when is God's kingdom? It is now. For the kingdom is when humanity and nature work together. It is when we little birds, we simple tiny sparrows, settle in those sturdy branches which have grown out of God's careful work in creation. A parable is a parable, a story and a secret. A parable is a story in its own right, which stretches our thinking to ever deeper and deeper wisdom. We are given a simple message as we are, who we are, where we are. Our job to apply this to our own lives and situations. We are called to nurture the seeds of faith inside us, to protect and to nourish them, and to trust God to allow them to mature inside us. For it makes a difference to how we live our lives if we realize that God is working secretly where our relationships are in turmoil, that God is working secretly where our hearts and minds are over-anxious and perplexed. When we are frustrated with the state of the world, God is bringing our faith to a deeper understanding and wisdom. For we are not alone. God's kingdom is rich and deep. There are many people of goodwill working hard for their children, in the hope of a better future for humankind, for a cleaner environment, for fair treatment of refugees, and welcome for migrants. Never underestimate the reach of God's kingdom, the power of the tree of life to sustain us. eyes on the sparrow. Plant it, to nurture it, and in God's time, bring it to fruition. And we pray for the seeds of faith that exist within this church. The seeds of faith which God has planted here. The seeds of faith of taking us on a journey. Perhaps we don't know the destination. We know that we should trust God. Trust God deeply and sincerely to take us where God wants us to be. so we pray for God to nurture our church, to care for it, to care for us, and to guide and direct us. And we pray this morning for all who are bereaved, especially those people who are remembering tragic events, especially the people of survivors of the Grenfell Tower fire, and all of the people who live in that part of North Kensington. Those churches meeting this morning, still grieving. And we pray too for those who knew Jo Cox, who loved her. And we give thanks for the seed that has spread from her tragic death into a symbol of hope for our communities. And we pray for those who are in need of rescue at this time, for those bobbing on flimsy boats in the Mediterranean, for those who are living in abusive and difficult relationships, for those who need a helping hand out of troubles which they have made for themselves, but still need rescue and support. We pray that we might have the wisdom and understanding to recognize that in the people we need meet. And we pray too for those in need of hope. We pray for our brothers and sisters of the Muslim faith who have just celebrated Eid following their period of fasting in Ramadan. We pray that Christians and Muslims and Jews, the children of Abraham, will continue to grow together in deep understanding of each other, each understanding our histories in different ways, but learning and supporting each other in all we do. And we pray to the God of love, the God who is part of all creation, the God who is creation, the God who is the driving force of creation. And we pray that we human beings may work cooperatively with understanding and wisdom with creation, with God, and not against, and not counter, and not in a destructive way. We pray that the God of love will be with us. The God of love will uplift us. The God of love will strengthen us. The God of love will defend us, and the God of love will inspire us. And together we pray, the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Have you got a new friend? You're the lucky one. I had to preach a sermon. Well, thank you all for coming, and thank you again to Claudina, who I didn't introduce actually, Claudina, for singing, and Masashi for singing, and then playing the organ. And our closing hymn, which those who arrived on time know, and those who are a little late will have to pick up as you go along, all are welcome, and during the hymn, an opportunity.
Thank you.
the world, helping ourselves to our neighbours, our loved ones, and opening ourselves to the grace of Jesus Christ. We say together, in the grace of our Lord Jesus.